breaking out of the silo, the need for broad security automation. We'll explain exactly what we mean by that in a little bit. First, we're just going to do a quick introduction.
So I'm Julian. I'm a security engineer at Rapid7. And a lot of my day-to-day is spending time doing exactly what we're about to talk about. And you know, while I am honeydew on this picture, we all know that Beatrix is in charge and the smart one, so it's on me.
I'm Justin Pagano. I'm the information security lead at Rapid7, specifically overseeing the operations and engineering function of the organization. So let's dive right in. Going back to the title of the slide, what do we mean by siloed automation and broad automation? Siloed automation, we all know about it, we're all doing this every day. Think about a tool that does a specific and sort of categorically limited set of tasks, like a vulnerability scanner or a firewall, and it's automating those tasks for you. So a vulnerability scanner is automatically discovering assets, discovering vulnerabilities, categorizing them, and reporting them. Broad automation, on the other hand, is where, like a mousetrap, you're taking disparate systems that all do and specialize in different things and tying them together, and tying them together in the context of a broader workflow or process. And we're going to dive into some use cases later on, but that's sort of the generic operating definition we're going to use from the top. So, why are we talking about broad automation? What are sort of the problems that we're trying to solve with it? There's a pretty well documented shortage of security staff in the US, across the globe. In the US, the number's about, from the peninsula, it's 209,000 unfilled but needed security positions. Across the globe, it's about 1 million, according to Cisco. And the flip side to that problem is, you know, we as defenders and security practitioners, we're definitely getting better at our jobs. In this case, from the DBIR, we're getting better at responding to incidents. But attackers are getting better faster than we are. And that's a problem, and that's sort of a gap we need to focus on closing.
So if we look back in the industry, we kind of see that major focus in the 1990s and 2000s was focused on automating prevention. So you had tools like firewall, AV, IDS, IPS, and these are a prime example of siloed automation. You know, you can automate within their own world context, so the firewall, you can automate rules and policy deployments, same with IDS, and same with AV, and maybe you could change some response activities from that, but you couldn't really do much more. So maybe a firewall could talk to an IDS, but not much more beyond the security lifecycle. And then moving to the late 2000s, we kind of had this merge into detection, so we had our favorite tool, the SIM, and you know, it gave us access to all the data, all of our event sources, and you know, we could build rules and do all this fun stuff, but still limited in the kind of detection phase. And then moving into the 2010s, we kind of moved back towards prevention again, but now it had a new name called Next Generation. So you had your Next Generation AV, so FireEye and sandboxing, and Next Generation Firewalls, which is back towards like application firewalls. And we're still kind of limited in the context and not really focusing on the whole security lifecycle.
This takes us to broad automation and, you know, sort of going back to what Julian was talking about before, in the context of the security lifecycle, the trends in the industry focused on prevention, a lot of tooling around prevention, a lot of money going into prevention. And we as security practitioners today, we know and we talk about how sort of short-sighted that was. Now we need to focus on detection, pouring a lot of money into that. But in this life cycle that we're all familiar with, it seems like the last stage hasn't gotten a lot of love in terms of tooling and automation and budget. And this is sort of the second aspect of broad automation. We're talking about automating the whole life cycle, whatever we can for any given process, and feed it into your detection tools, and then take that out of your detection tool and manually run some process to correct or respond to or remediate an issue. And before we move on, just want to issue some caveats. We're not saying you're going to automate everything 100%. We're not saying there's a silver bullet. We're not saying people aren't doing this today. What we are saying is this is a basic foundational building block that ought to be a part of every security program whenever we have the opportunity to put it there. And this is something we really should have been focusing on years ago so that we could free up the time that our security personnel have day to day so they can focus on the things that humans are good at. Creative thought, engaging in dynamic processes that aren't predictable or repeatable, and also writing more code to further refine your automating processes.
So before we go on to any strategies that we have to cover some basic assumptions. Any tools that you have or plan on getting are going to have to have API capabilities so that you can kind of interact with them in an automated fashion. They have to be open and rich enough to do a minimal job. They're not going to do everything that you want right off the bat. So you're going to have to kind of tie different systems together to do one thing. So an example of this at Rapid7 is we have a bunch of different data sources for our users. And as a security team, we wanted to kind of consolidate all of that. So we integrated our single sign-on provider API and our HRIS provider and a couple other tools and mashed it all together to this one system so that we have one single source for our users. And then we start using that for other tools. And another assumption is programming skills. To be able to interact with APIs and build these tools, you have to be able to program. You don't have to be a lead programmer. Rapid7 and our team are big on passion, so programming can be taught. Just the way of thinking is what we're big on. And the last assumption is time. And prompt automation is not as easy as buying a tool to solve a problem. You're going to have to tie different tools together. You're going to have to figure all that out, and it takes time to iterate. And it's worth it in the long run to be able to have all your tools tied together in an automated fashion.
So some of the core features of strategy behind broad automation, again, we're talking about automating repeatable processes that you might be doing manually today. We're also talking about automating across, again, disparate systems and tools, but also across different teams, whether those are teams within your security organization or between security and IT and DevOps and HR and marketing. I'm sure you can think of some processes you engage in on a day-to-day or week-to-week basis where you have certain roles in the security team partnering with certain roles in a non-security team. And if any of those steps in that workflow are repeated and predictable, why not automate? And then another caveat, some of you might be thinking, well, you're talking about automating everything. It's kind of scary, or if you're talking about computers automating certain actions, maybe automating changes to certain systems. Yes, that can be a little scary, but let's extend that idea and think about, well, why not automate rollbacks of those automated changes? Again, if we're talking about predictable actions and changes, we should know and be able to predict what the rollbacks to those changes should be to fix a problem that might be created by one of these automated steps. And again, I want to highlight that we're not going to be able to automate everything. If you do have a workflow, though, where you can automate 90, 95% of it, but your organization isn't comfortable with automating certain steps, especially the steps that make changes to systems, throw in some manual steps, some push-button approval stages to fit your organization's needs.
And we'll have some in our next use cases. We have some ideas for manual steps that we see that probably will come up.
Yeah, it's probably reasonable to have a few, just in case. So, use cases, vulnerability management and patch management. Show of hands, how many people have dealt with this or deal with this today? It's a pretty common use case, absolutely necessary to any organization. And for these use cases, we have this legend down here. Green stages are automated, orange are manual. And this is, in our eyes, sort of a average current state at a lot of companies. You have your vulnerability scanner, it's automating that stage. You're manually submitting tickets and change requests. You might have a patch management tool where a system administrator is queuing up patches to apply to systems at a later date. And then that person will send out a notification to the company or potentially impacted users saying, hey, patches are coming down, your system's gonna reboot in 24 hours, just so you know. Patch management tool applies those patches, the vuln scanner rescans to validate that the patches took, and then someone goes in and closes out those two tickets. This is clunky. This is going to take a lot of time, and it's not the most exciting thing to do every day or every week. Why not automate as much as possible. There are plenty of opportunities, especially with modern tools, modern ticketing tools and vulnerability management tools, to tie these things together so that anytime you can predict these vulnerabilities from my vulnerability scanning tool, they pair up with these patches in my patch management tool. Let's get them staged. Let's get them rolled out in 2 weeks between these times. We know what our maintenance window is. We can add that into this automated workflow, and we have minimal human intervention. If this is scaring you, though, I might scare you a little more. If you want to get a little more creative here, and you're thinking, well, my organization, we can't tolerate having workstations out there that remain unpatched for 2 weeks. We have users who aren't connecting to the corporate network very often, and the last time we saw them, they were missing the past 2 months of Microsoft Patch Tuesday updates. If you have notifications going out to those users saying, hey, you need to work with IT to get patched in 2 weeks or your network access gets revoked, you can tie this workflow into your network management systems or firewalls to automatically quarantine that asset so it can't interact with any systems on your corporate network until it gets patched and until your vulnerability scanner tool validates that the patch is took. I might be freaking some of you out. Let's say you don't want to automate everything. You don't want those patches to just go out willy-nilly. Throw in a manual step where an IT administrator or someone from the security team needs to go in and push approve on that change request in order for that workflow to proceed going forward. And again, any of these stages, you can just throw in manual steps or leave any stage entirely manual if your organization deems it too risky to make these changes on the fly like that. And I just want to highlight too, we're talking about tying together four different types of systems. It's very doable. It's stuff we do and are doing more of at Rapid7 every day. And it really can help your teams focus on more important things to help mature your security program and to deal with alerts that are coming in on a day-to-day basis. This really is a time saver.
So another use case is, much simpler than what Justin just covered, but it's firewall configuration management. So that goes from defining your policies and standards and rules, configuring those firewalls, and hopefully auditing those policies and rules and making sure they stick to the standard, and then reacting to any deviations. A lot of this is very manual across a lot of teams. You'll have a team maybe defining the policies and standards, another team actually writing the rules, and then you maybe have another team auditing the policies and rules, and then they're going to respond to having another team maybe fix those deviations or alert or some kind of process around that. And you're covering a lot of tools, a lot of teams, and you can kind of see that this is pretty hectic, and you could definitely have some room for automation. So here, let's say we have a policy in place. So this is your defining your policy and standards for your web servers who have port 80 and 443 open to public addresses, so that's non-RFC 1918 addresses. You draft those policies, and then hopefully you have some kind of maybe GUI tool or something a little bit easier and more automated than actually going to the firewall and writing the rule in command line. And then you have an automated process of going through, scanning those rules and policies and making sure it's all standard. But then you come up with, there's now this rule that has port 22 open to some random public IP address that you don't own. And, now you're stuck. What do we do? So you have an automated process that goes through, alerts your information security team, and maybe, hopefully, automatically either comment out that rule, track down through your config management repo, see who put that rule in, and following up with that and, doing that process. And then you have an ability to roll back. So during this process, you find that, we needed this for some troubleshooting. Probably a bad for this use case because I don't know why you want 22 open. But you have the ability to roll back and then put that rule back in place in a simple fashion versus having a bunch of tickets open and manually following that up and all of that. Do you have any questions so far? So another use case as... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So how much is your automation tied to a particular product such that if you were to swap out your firewall, you would have to change a certain amount of automation? Is there a plug-in layer that allows you to make the least amount of changes when something like that happens?
So at least on our team, we try to, when we write services for those type of tasks, we kind of make it generic enough that, like, oh, I want to block something, this, and then we write plugins, like you're saying, for this particular tool, and then when we're looking to purchase, either replace a tool or a new tool, we look for stuff that has similar API capabilities so that, you know, we're not stuck in, like, now we replaced our firewall, but we can't actually block anything through an API. So that's kind of always in our mindset to be able to do that. So another use case as defenders is responding to phishing alerts and stuff. It's pretty common. We're all doing it. And it's crazy because you hopefully maybe have an automated tool that alerts you. Maybe you have your users send you phishing emails for you to analyze. You have a bunch of tabs open for different analysis tools, virus total, malware, some kind of sandboxing to see if there's any kind of malicious attachments, and then URLs. Go to URL query to get screenshots to see what that website looks like. Then you have a message trace to see who else got that email, and then track that down, notify any users who may have opened the email and see if they interacted, and then you have to follow up with that. Once you deem that, you know, there's a bunch of malicious domains, you have to reach out to abuse contacts so they can shut that domain down. And then you also have to update your prevention tools for any indicators of compromise, so whether that be your firewall, AV, spam filters, what have you. And, you know, a lot of this is manual. When I first started Rapid7, this was a big chunk of our time initially, coming up with, you know, an SOP for it, and it was all manual. And so we switched to a significantly automated fashion, and this kind of kicked us off into thinking broader in automation. So we tied in our, you know, our web API so we can automatically pull in web phishing emails and, you know, have create services that analyze the links, the attachments, submit it to VirusTotal, get the results back. We've created a service that takes screenshots of websites, and then we kind of do that automatically instead of opening a tab in a URL query. You can start tracing messages automatically, assuming, again, that there's an API for it, and you get a feel for who else got this kind of message based on the subject and the from. And, you know, you can maybe, if you have a confidence level, okay, I'm 80% sure that this message is malicious, you can automatically delete that email from the mailbox, or on the flip side, have a push button. So if you have like a GUI representation and you don't feel comfortable automatically deleting an email, like, push this button because, you know, we're 70% sure or 80% sure, and then we can go from there. Automatically emailing users to say, oh, we noticed this phishing email and you got it. Please let us know if you interacted with it in any way. And again, automatically notifying abuse contacts and updating your firewalls and any of your tools for any indicators of compromise that you found during your analysis. And by automating all of this, you can start focusing on, you know, what kinds of emails or phishing emails am I getting, who's being targeted, who's, you know, how can we use this information to maybe even phish our own company for better campaigns. And you're not focused on, like, trying to always react to a phishing email. You're kind of taking a proactive stance. And, you know, that's what we're trying to find. That's what we're trying to do at Rapid7. So next, we have some bonus screenshots. And I apologize if they don't come up. I kind of just did it this morning. But we have this GUI front end where people... So at Rapid7, we have users submit phishing emails that they think is suspicious or phishing. And then we have our services automatically parse those. And it's represented in a GUI. This is the first one where it kind of comes up as a ticket and a workflow. And then this next one, which will be pretty bad, but it's, you know, if you can see, they have some screenshots of any websites and URLs. We automatically pull VirusTotal and get the results for that. And it's all represented in a single page so that we're not having, you know, six tabs open for all these things. And yeah, so it's, you know, it's kind of do analysis from there. And we found that it saves us a bunch of time rather than, again, like having all this running around like a chicken with its head cut off, which is a lot of times what defenders do.
So before I go into the next use case, I just want to highlight quickly about the phishing analysis use case, how that whole workflow, again, we automated to a great extent the whole security lifecycle for that workflow. We have prevention tools already in place, spam and phishing filters. A lot of phishing emails get past them, so we have detection mechanisms in place that we've automated. And that detection mechanism in that workflow is twofold. Our employees, they will manually notify us. They'll send us phishing emails to a certain mailbox. But then this tool we built will automatically notify us when an employee has reported a phishing email that got past our filters. We automate all the analysis. And then in the final stages, we go in and we automate correction. We add the sending email address of that phishing email to our spam and phishing filters, so it'll get blocked again. And we're adding those indications of compromise to some of our other tools, like file hashes and URLs to web proxies and things like that. So we're automating that correction phase so that it feeds back into the beginning, prevention, and it just continues iterating on itself in effect. Next use case, access management. We've been dealing with this forever. But for us, we're trying to come up with flexible and still secure ways to provision access, especially to critical production systems. We had this problem where we're trying to both allow people who need access to production servers to get access when they need it without giving them persistent access, without just having their account on there until the end of time. We felt that was too risky, and so we've been taking this process, which is probably automated to this extent at a lot of companies, and we took it a step further, and so that a user, an administrator or an engineer, can log into a web portal. They go to request access, which is pretty standard in a ticketing system, but in this use case, they specify, I need access to these five servers for just an hour. And they click a button, and their account gets automatically provisioned just on those systems. And after provisioning occurs and they log in for the first time, their activity is being monitored at a granular level. And that activity audit log, when the user is done on that system, gets sent off to a security analyst, and they just check out to make sure everything's kosher. Because in this case, we're talking about critical production systems. We really want to be careful about, even for authorized users, what changes they're making on those servers.
So the problem with some of those type systems is that a person never logs off. A time limit isn't going to help you at all.
I'm talking about
application systems like Linux and those kind of things.
Yeah, so we could throw in a step there to kill sessions.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a great point, too. You weren't really...
Yeah, with the caveat that won't break anything, because, you have to kind of do the information gathering and say, okay, these users will need to be logged in indefinitely. Can't think of a good use case why that would happen, but again, like you would say, okay, these users allowed to log in, we don't want to kill their sessions because that may impact the system.
Yeah, and just another thought, too, before you even automatically kill the session, send out a few automated notifications. We see you're still logged in. Do you still need to be logged in? After 5 notification attempts, all right, we're killing your access.
Yeah.
You're welcome. Good question. And for the last slide, we've gone over a lot of technical use cases, and for some teams, we think that when we're talking about automation, we're focusing a lot on automating the workflows of a security operations center or a technical security team, but really we should be thinking broader, if I can, across the entire security organization. So if you have a governance and compliance team that is getting out a new policy to the company, like an acceptable use policy, automate that workflow so the document from your document management system gets pushed out to all applicable employees. You're sending reminders automatically. You're tracking how many reminders have been sent so that after 10 reminders, let's say, if an employee hasn't acknowledged or signed the new policy, you escalate to their manager, maybe you escalate to the security team again, and after 20, 30 reminders, if they still haven't signed it, quarantine their machine, revoke their network access. Once you get acknowledgments and signatures, remove them from the quarantine, and track that all in real time as those acknowledgments come in. Yes, sir.
With the automation, sending the daily reminders, what would you say the acknowledgement rate tends to be? How frequently would you find yourself in a situation where you need to quarantine devices?
For us, it's been pretty rare. I haven't looked at our recent numbers for our most recent campaign.
Our recent campaign, it was pretty successful. We maybe had a few stragglers that had a reason maybe to definitely escalate to their managers, but we didn't have a policy in place for quarantine because we don't want to just quarantine someone's box without having that notice before, that if you don't sign it, we're going to quarantine your box. So, something that we could definitely work into the future.
But yeah, again, we're tying together a lot of disparate systems to free up our security resources time to focus on better things. And that's it.
And in summation, automate like a boss.
Yes, of course. Any questions? We have an answer. Yes?
So across all of our workflows, there's always approval lists or lists of people you have to send them out to. Do you manage them within the workflow, or do you pull them from other places? Do you manage many lists of approvers? How does that work?
For that last use case, you mean?
For all of them, really. I mean,
for any approval stage.
For people that need to approve things or not, no payment. How do you maintain those approvers?
So for the vulnerability management use case, for example, and for others, really, the systems we're building it's fair to say they're full stack. You know, there's the web layer, we have a database layer, and that database is tracking different approvals. And having the database helps you normalize all that data too. So we're not just stuck in the data format of the ITSM tool where that approval is clicked. And it helps us to maintain that record as well in case changes are made in the original system. We can have our own source of record to double check things, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and also, like, when we're creating the service, we define the business rules of these are the types of people we want for the escalations and for the approvals. And then I mentioned the user service that we kind of built. And based on those business rules, it'll call it the service. We'll pull in, okay, I need the IT director. It'll pull in that, and we can start working off those workflows. So nothing's really hard-coded as far as the person, but maybe the role is hard-coded that we need to contact this person.
Do you use any kind of common rules framework across all of these different workflows, or are these kinds of separate programs?
Right now, it's pretty separate. Like we're just getting growing our team and growing all of the services that we're coming up with, and each kind of person on our team has kind of come up with their own thing, and we're starting to unify things a lot better by having one single repository for our users and a single repository for our assets. We're not defining all of that information multiple times, so like that's kind of where we're starting to head.
Yeah, well, that's a conversation we actually had pretty recently again.
Yeah.
Having a business rules repository of sorts.
Yeah.
Because and again too, like when you start automating these processes, you're not going to automate everything from start to finish. You'll do it piecemeal. And then once you get one workflow automated and then a separate workflow automated, you can start focusing on that sort of central business rules policy system and repository for it. And that just speaks back to the idea of once you start automating things more broadly like this, you're able to iterate on that automation and mature your security program much more easily than you otherwise would have if everything were still just manual.
So it seems like at the moment, your focus is, you're saying, automate it, and then to the extent that you're not comfortable with the automation's effectiveness and function, stick those approval steps in. It makes perfect sense, and this is awesome. Have you gone past that point where on those processes that you have fully automated, that you've taken those approval steps out of, that you actually have done anomaly detection or other rules to kind of figure out when the fully automated process and when is going wrong and when you need to put the brakes on it, and what lessons have you learned from that if you've done that?
That's a good point, and we will definitely start figuring that out as far as like working that into our services. Like we're just getting started, and these ideas, and once we start having more mature automated processes, that's definitely something that we need to start looking out for.
So can you give us an understanding of, I think everybody is kind of familiar with Rapid Summit, but just so we understand, the size of your organization, the number of users, and how many people that you put to doing the automation.
What we've done, the three of us so far have built a good number of tools.
So
we have another person focusing on just one workflow, and they're off on their own
doing other jobs, across the day too. It's not like somebody's going to focus on this full time, but just an understanding of where you would rank in size as a company.
So Rapid7's roughly 700, 800 people, and our security team, at least the engineering operations side, is four of us, and we have a lead, which is Justin, and we have a few other engineers that are actually you know, maybe 70% of the time focusing on taking manual steps and, you know, into an automated process. And then as we start doing the other, I guess, 30% is manual, we start working in that as a project. Okay, how can we automate this?
And for a good amount of time, we were all, to an extent, sharing the workload on automating a certain process. But now we're starting to sort of crystallize into specialized roles, and you know, one person's focusing on this over here, the other's there. But in terms of the operations side, especially for these processes that are generating alerts that we need to respond to, we're all sort of sharing the responsibility around that. Did that answer your question?
Yeah. Are you doing everything in Python? I saw the Python screenshot.
Most of it's in Ruby, some of it's in Python. Like we, as we hire new like team members, we don't really care like what language you're writing in. It's usually sticks to Python and Ruby because that's usually where our expertise lies. But as long as the service is working and like you're able to support it and documentation is relatively good, like, that's really all that matters to us.
We're really looking forward to refactoring everything into Go. Right?
Yeah, I hear Go is pretty popular, so we'll probably rewrite everything. So.
Yeah.
I'm sure there are other companies out there that maybe don't have a security team as big as you guys do or have the expertise.
To commercialize it?
Yeah.
Yeah, we just work on the security team. We don't.
Yeah, we don't.
Our heads are down all day. We have no idea what anyone else is doing.
There's a platform called Phantom, you guys here, that's doing a lot of this code modules and stuff.
Yeah.
That looks like it's got a ton of potential.
So there's Phantom, there's Command, which you'll see people walking around in a green shirt. I mean, there's a lot of like security orchestration products that are coming on the market.
Yes.
I think you really have to weigh whether the cost of those is worth it versus writing some Python script yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you recommend just like a good starting point if you're looking to, you know, automate a process? Where would you first?
For us, the phishing analysis workflow was a great starting point, and I'm pretty sure a lot of companies deal with that. I guess I'm biased, but I would recommend that. It's straightforward enough. You know, you can set up a mailbox that employees can send all that into, and then you can start to pull out those emails and test parsing them. And then move to the next step, integrate with some sort of link analysis system, file analysis system, and you just iterate on that slowly, and then all of a sudden it all ties together, and you're like, how did I find the time to do all that?
Yeah, we were fortunate for being able to have a mail service that supports APIs, so like that's where like, we saw that capability, like, oh, well, we can easily automate this, and we also started like independently developing services. Because a lot of times, if you want to look up a domain to see if it's malicious, we open a bunch of tabs outside of the phishing use case. So we built some services to do that, and then we started incorporating that into the phishing workflow so that everything works seamlessly.
And I guess I had to answer that question with my own bias, just because there are probably so many other processes out there we haven't thought about automating yet, and that's kind of the point of the talk. Sort of bring this idea to the forefront of everyone's mind, so when you go back to work next week and you engage in that day-to-day process you've been doing for the past few years, you stop and think, wait a second, I do this over and over again. Isn't there a system I could plug into or tie two systems together just to get this one step done, and then think about the other steps in that process?
Specifically regarding your phishing workflow, do you see any, like, how do you treat handle incident response within this process? I saw there's correction and then you add this made to filters and stuff like that, but what if people clicked on links and actually executed malicious emails and code and stuff like that? Is this considered as part of that workflow?
Yeah, and we didn't have stages on there for that, just to keep it simple, but you know, you can imagine that if you have some kind of IDS, IPS tool or web proxy where you can see, okay, I got this phishing email from an employee. It's definitely malicious, and there's a link in there. Did anyone else visit that link? You correlate that across your proxy tools, what have you. Then you can narrow that down to all the users that actually visited the link. You can see if anything was actually returned. Is it a dead link? Was it just a 404 or something? Or no, it was a 200, and oh, it looks like a file gets dropped. If you're brave enough and you know, like, okay, that machine is screwed, you can add that quarantine step to the workflow. If you have a remote imaging system, you could add that to the workflow. Say, okay, we're going to quarantine the box, we're going to do a little more analysis to see what happened, and then once we're confident that we can just blow this away and reissue something, let's remotely wipe it or re-image it, pick it up later, give them a loaner laptop or something like that. That's definitely something to consider for that workflow and to add into it.
Yeah.